Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our morning session. Today we have a purely Italian session. And first speaker is Vincenzo Ambrosio from Polytechnical University della Marche. Please, Vincenzo.
Thank you. First, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak about my research. In this talk, I will discuss the existence of periodic solutions for a fractional problem. Sorry to give. Okay. We will consider the following problem. Here we have the s power of this elliptic operator. S is a real positive number between 0 and 1, m is greater or equal than 0, the dimension n is greater or equal than 4s, 2 star is the fractional critical exponent, and the capital W, and f are continuous functions, whose assumptions will be stated later. The fractional operator minus Laplacian plus n squared 2s can be defined the following way. More precisely, if u is a infinity function 2 pi periodic in each variable, then u can be represented by using a Fourier series. Here ck are the Fourier coefficients of u. Then the s power of this elliptic operator evaluated at u is given by the sum on zeta n of the s powers of the eigenvalues of this elliptic operator with periodic boundary conditions multiplied by ck and each term, each element of the trigonometric system. We note that this identity is pointwise because u is infinity, but we can extend this definition for any u belonging to the following Hilbert space, that is capital H, which is given by the set of function in R2 in minus pi pi 2n, such that the following quantity is finite. One of the main reasons of studying the previous operator is related to its physical meaning. Indeed, when s is equals 1/2, the square root of minus Laplacian plus m square minus m in Rn is the Hamiltonian operator of a free relativistic particle of mass m. We recall that the spectral properties of this operator have been strongly influenced by the works of Libe on the stability of the relativistic matter. It is also possible to give an alternative interpretation of the following operator. Indeed, from a probabilistic point of view, in fact, this operator corresponds to the infinitesimal generator of a Levy process called the stable relativistic process. And for results for this operator in Levy processes theory, we recall some results to Carmona, Master Simon, Ritzner, and his collaborators. Our paper has been motivated by two works. The first one is due to Barrios Colorado de Pablo Sanchez, who considered the following fractional problem. Here, this operator represents the spectral Laplacian, which may be defined in similar way with respect to our operator, but by using the eigenvalues of minus Laplacian with homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions. And S is a real positive number between 0 and 1, omega is a smooth bounded domain, lambda is positive, and Q is positive and less than 2 star minus 1. And in this paper, the authors generalized a well-known result to Ambrosetti, Brezzi, and Cerami concerning the existence and multiplicity of a boundary value problem with critical growth. A second paper is due to Servadé and Valdinoci, who obtained the existence of non-trivial solutions or trivial solution for the following problem. Here we have the fractional Laplacian, which may be defined by using the Fourier transform. S is a real positive number between 0 and 1. Omega is a Lipschitz bounded domain. The dimension n is greater or equal than for S. Lambda is less than or the first eigen value of the fractional Laplacian with non local Dirichlet boundary condition. We note that these two operators are different because their spectrum is different. For instance, for the fractional Laplacian, the first eigenvalue is less than or the first eigenvalue of the spectral Laplacian, and the eigenfunctions of the fractional Laplacian are older continuous, while the eigenvalues of the spectral Laplacian are infinity if the domain is smooth enough. Anyway, these two problems can be considered as a fractional analog of the following classical boundary value problem. We recall that the existence of periodic solutions for ODEs and PDEs has been investigated by several authors, such as Ambrosetti, Bash, Benci, Moen, Moser, Rabinowitz, Struve, and many others. And our goal is to give a periodic version of this problem. So we replace the Dirichlet boundary condition with the periodic boundary condition. And in particular, we replace the local operator minus Laplacian by the fractional operator minus Laplacian plus m squared to s. To study our problem, we use a variant of the Caffarelli-Silvestre extension method in periodic setting. More precisely, for any u in capital H, we can find a function v in capital X, Sm, where capital X is defined as the closure of this infinity function in this upper upper space, which is 2 pi periodic in each variable xi, with respect to the following H1 norm, with weight xi to 1 minus 2s. So V solves the following degenerate elliptic equation in this cylinder. We have a periodic boundary condition, the lateral boundary of the cylinder, and the trace of V is equals to the is equals to datum U on the bottom of the cylinder. We recall that this approach to study fractional problem is well known in literature. In particular, the extension method has been extended for spectral operators by Cabretan and Capella Davila du Pagnessire and Brande Colorado de Pablo Sanchez. And for a more general result, we refer to Sting et Torrea. In particular, we can see that the exterior conormal derivative of V coincides up to a constant to our operator evaluated at U in the dual sense. And by using these informations, we can see instead of studying the starting non-local problem, we look for weak solutions for the following local problem. Here we have a degenerate elliptic equation in the cylinder, a periodic boundary condition on the lateral boundary of the cylinder, and a non-linear, and a normal non-linear boundary condition on the bottom of the cylinder. Here, for weak solution for the extended problem two, we mean a function, functions v in capital X, such that the following identity holds for any psi in capital X. Now we state the main assumptions on the capital W and F. We assume that capital W is a continuous function which is positive and 2 pi periodic, which achieves its maximum at zero. And we have the following behavior near zero. The following flatness condition. And concerning our nonlinearity f, we assume that it is a continuous function which is 2 pi periodic in x variable. F over t goes to zero when t goes to zero uniformly in x. F is as a subcritical group at infinity. And moreover, we assume that f is a superlinear. In fact, we assume the following Ambrosetti-Rabinowitz condition. Finally, we suppose that there exists a function of bar f such that f is greater or equal than of bar f on a set capital A, which is a non-empty open set. And moreover, we assume that the following relational limit holds. We note that if we take bar capital F bar equals T2P, the following relation is satisfied. We says that the flatness condition, when S is equals one, the flatness condition on the potential appeared in several papers. For instance, we refer to Escobar and Chablowski-Young for critical problems. Moreover, concerning the assumption F5, when S is equals one, a similar condition can be found in the seminal paper de Dubrezier and Nirenberg, who study the existence of positive solutions for a boundary value problem with the critical growth. Now we state the first main result. We assume that M is positive, and we assume that the condition on capital W and F are satisfied. Then we can find a non-constant periodic solution of problem one, which is order continuous. This result has been motivated by two previous papers in which I studied the existence of periodic solutions for fractional problems, but involving subcritical nonlinearities. With respect to these two papers, the main difficulties related to the lack of compactness of the embedding of the space capital H into the Lebesgue space R2 star. And this does not permit to verify that the Palaismel condition holds at any level seen R. Due to the variational nature of the extended problem two, we look for weak solutions of our problem by using variational methods. More precisely, we obtain a periodic solution by using the linking theorem. First, we observe that the solutions of problem two can be obtained as critical point of the following Euler-Lagrange functional. We note that here I use the following notation for the LP norm of the trace of the functions V in capital X. And we can observe that this function is well defined in C1 as a consequence of the following trace inequality: the continuous embedding of the space capital X into Lebesgue spaces LQ for any Q between one and two stars S, the growth conditions on F, and the condition the capital W1. Here we recall the linking theorem of Rabinowitz. We assume that capital X is a real Banach space which can be split into the sum of two subspaces, capital Y and capital Zeta, where capital Y is finite dimensional. We suppose that there exists a rho greater than R, which are positive. Zeta and capital Zeta whose norm is equals to R. We introduce the following subsets. And we assume that J is a C1 functional such that the infimum of J on capital NR is greater than the maximum of J on capital N0. We define the linking critical level alpha, which is given by the inf max or J gamma B, where gamma belongs to the capital gamma, which is the set of the path from continuous path from M to capital M to capital X, such that gamma is equal to the identity map on capital M0, and V belongs to capital M. And if J satisfies the Palaismel condition at the level alpha, then alpha is a critical value of J. In order to apply the linking theorem, we first note that capital X can be split into the sum of the following subsets. Capital Y, which is given by the subspace generated by theta and xi, where theta is a solution of the following ODE, And we note that theta can be expressed by using the modified Bessel function of second type. And capital zeta is the orthogonal complement of capital Y with respect to the inner product in capital X, which is Hilbert space. More precisely, capital zeta is given by the set of function B in capital X, such that whose trace has mean zero. Okay, here we give a sketch of the proof. We note that Jm is non-positive on capital Y because the quadratic part of our functional vanishes if and only if V is a multiple of theta and xi. And moreover, by using the condition F4, we can see that capital F is non-negative. Moreover, we can prove that the infimum of Jm is positive on the boundary of a small ball in capital zeta. To prove this, we use a sort of a Poincaré inequality, which permits to prove that the quadratic part of our function is equivalent to capital X norm for any b in capital zeta. To overcome the lack of compactness of capital H into R2 star, we define a suitable truncated periodic function, zeta epsilon, which is given by the difference between phi epsilon minus the average of phi epsilon with respect to x variable multiplied theta and xi. Here, phi epsilon is given by the product of phi, which is a radial cutoff function, and psi epsilon, which is given by the S-harmonic extension of W epsilon. Here, capital P to S is the Poisson kernel, and W epsilon is given by this. This function is related to the equality for the fractional Sobolev inequality, and phi, and this term represents the average of phi epsilon with respect to the X norm.
3 minutes.
Okay. In particular, we can see that phi epsilon satisfy the following estimates, and in particular, we can deduce that the quadratic part of our function evaluated in zeta epsilon is less than of the L2 norm of the gradient of phi epsilon with weight xi to 1 minus 2s. So we can see that the maximum of Jm is less than of the threshold value, C star. And in particular, we can prove that Jm satisfied the Pallet-Smith condition at any level C less than C star. Finally, we can prove that the supremum of Jm on the boundary of capital M epsilon is equals to zero. So we can apply the linking theorem, and we can see that for any m, a positive m, we can find a function bm, which is a critical point of our function. In particular, we can study the regularity of this critical point. Indeed, by combining a Brezzicato type argument with the Moser iteration scheme, we can deduce that bm belongs to LQ for any q between 2 and infinity. And by using standard elliptic estimates, we can prove that our solution is order continuous. And finally, we are able to obtain the existence of a periodic solution for the starting problem when m is equals zero. To prove this, we use a procedure of limit. More precisely, we first prove that the linking critical level can be estimated from below and from above by two positive constants, provided that m is sufficiently small. By using the upper bound, we are able to pass to the limit in the weak formulation of the starting problem, so that we are able to obtain the existence of a periodic solution. By using the lower bound, we are able to prove that this solution is indeed non-trivial. Okay. Thank you for the attention.
Okay, let's thank the speaker.
Thank you.
Questions, comments, or remarks?
Good morning. I have a question. In your theorem, you said that your solution is a non-constant. What do you mean? So you mean that for all variable, this is non-constant, or you don't include the case when in part of variable, it can be constant, or for other variable, for instance?
No. It's not constant with respect to each variable.
So this means at least for one variable, non-constant.
X variable.
I think it should depend on the function V, W.
No, you consider the trace of function. You obtain the existence of a 2-pi periodic with respect to X variable, the extension.
Yes, but if W is not a constant, then you cannot have a constant solution, I think. It depends on W.
Because in the proof, you are able to prove that U is not identical to zero.
Non-zero, it is another stuff.
No, you prove that U is not identical to zero, but if you look the problem, then U is non-constant, cannot be constant. You consider the starting problem.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Then U cannot be constant, because if U is constant, we have here zero, F is positive, and W is positive. So it is not possible that U is constant.
Okay, I saw Alexei Filinovsky would like to ask something. Is it correct or not? Probably not. More questions?
Yeah, perhaps I have a question. I'm Roberta Musina. Ciao, Vincenzo.
Ciao, Roberta.
You are assuming n greater than 4s. Does it mean that you can observe a phenomena like critical dimension or something like that?
Because you use this restriction to obtain some useful estimates, but maybe it is possible to remove this condition. Because in a paper, Dutu, Servadev, Baldinucci, they are able to extend Brezzini-Rebberg result in any dimension with n to s.
I guess I know.
Maybe possible to do it.
Okay. Thanks. There is no other question, please thank the speaker again.
Thank you very much.